united with Christ. Meet local churches with open doors, serving throughout the Border Valley community and sharing the truth and hope of God's love and salvation. A presentation of Life Christian Broadcasting Television. And now, United with Christ.
Good morning. Welcome to United with Christ. My name is Edith Sobioch, and I would like to thank Life Christian Television for giving me the opportunity again this morning to speak to you and to bring the Word of God forth and to let Jesus come into your heart this morning and to comfort you and to be with you. And I also want to thank God for that He will be with me this morning, and I'd like to open in prayer. Holy Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, I come before your throne, and I thank you, Lord God, that you gave me another time of speaking your word to your people out there, Father, that are hurting. So many people are lost. So many people are hurting all around us, Lord. And I just thank you and I praise you, Lord, for letting me do this. And I ask you, Holy Spirit, that you will give me the words to say and that you will speak through me this morning, Lord, and make me your mouthpiece and reach those people and touch these people and comfort them, Father, by your holy word in the name of Jesus Christ. And I also want to thank all my friends out there that are faithfully praying for me every day and supporting me in this and giving me comfort when I get discouraged. And so I thank you. And this morning I want to talk about faith through hardship. And we all get hit in life. Life is hard sometimes. Life is very hard. And you know, without Jesus Christ, we can do nothing. We can do absolutely nothing. And sometimes hardship comes in our lives because God is still molding us. God wants to do something in our lives, and He is nudging us. He is calling us. He wants to get our attention. He says, come on, come to me, ye that are heavy laden. Bring me your burdens. Give them to me. Cast all your care on me, for my yoke is easy and light. And so God wants to help us. But you know, a lot of times we become rebellious. We get disobedient to God's word. Maybe we don't know God's word. Maybe we don't know what the Holy Spirit has written in the Holy Bible. Because people do not read the Bible a lot of times, and they don't familiarize themselves with what Jesus has to say. And so naturally, God does not give up on us, and He keeps nudging us, and He keeps calling us, and He keeps saying, come on, come on, do what I'm telling you to do. I don't do you any harm. I don't want to hurt you, but you're going your own way. And if we go our own way, then hardships will come. Sometimes God will test us. He tested Abraham. Oh my, did He ever test Abraham? How hard do you think it was when God told Abraham to leave his country and pack up his family and pack up all his servants and his animals and just go and pitch a tent wherever they were? You think that was easy? And then when God told Abraham to take his son Isaac, which was the promised son, and to take him up to the mountain and sacrifice him there to God. But God did it. Abraham did it. And Abraham never lost his faith. So Abraham was obedient because he knew that God would not do anything that he could not do. And look at Job. Job was another one. Job was a righteous man. He was a man of God. He was the richest man in the whole country. He had 10 children. He had thousands of animals. He had servants. He had it all. But he was righteous. God said he was a very righteous man. Well, one day there was this big storm. It came and all his 10 children died. All his animals in the fields died. His servants, except one, they all died. One servant came and brought Job the bad news and said, I am so sorry, I'm the only one that escaped. I'm the only one that escaped. Everybody's gone, your children are gone, all the oxen, all the sheep, all the camels, everything is gone. And Job was so sad and he was so grieved and he was so upset. So he shaved his head and he put on sackcloth and he dropped to the floor, he dropped to the ground and he worshiped. He worshiped in all that he lost, in all that pain, in all that heartache. He worshiped and he never sinned. And he said, God give it and God take it away. So there's Job. Then you have Daniel. Remember Daniel? He was thrown to the lions. He prayed and he was told by the king that he could no longer pray and worship his God, because his king did not believe in his God, in our God. And so Daniel, he worshiped anyway. And every day at noon, he stood by the open window and he prayed and he praised the Lord. Well, he got thrown into the lion's den during the night. There was these hungry lions. I don't know how many there were, but they were hungry. They kept them starved, so they would feast on these people that would be thrown into the lion's den. Well, Daniel went in there, but God was with him, and God protected him, and God shut the lions' mouths. And these lions, I'm sure they were roaring and growling at him all day and circling around him, wanting to bite him and want to devour him. But the angel of the Lord did not allow that. And what did Daniel do? He worshiped, he prayed, and that's why God protected him. And then the three Hebrew children, Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego, they were men of God. They loved the Lord. And the king also, he has said, I want you, you can no longer pray to your God. You have to worship the image, my image. Well, that was the false God. And these three Hebrew men, they said, no, we're not going to do that. We are going to worship our God. What happened? They built a big fire. The king had a big fire built, 7 times hotter than the normal fire would be. And they threw all three of those guys into that fire. And when they looked into the fire, they saw 4 men in the fire. They saw Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the fire. But they saw another man in the fire, and that was the Son of God. That was Jesus Christ himself. Jesus was in the fire with those three Hebrew children. And they never got burned. They never got burned. They came out of the fire. There was no smoke on them. There was not one hair singed. Because they worshiped God and they believed in God and they trusted God. You think that was easy when they were told you're going to have to be thrown into the fire and burn alive? Or when Daniel was told that he had to go into the lion's den and be eaten up by these hungry lions? Those were trials. Those were tribulations. Those were hardships. But they kept their eyes on Jesus. And there's all in Matthew chapter 14, verses 24 to 31, talks about when Peter and his disciples went over the sea in a ship, and the sea was roaring. It was almost like a hurricane, and the waves and everything. And Jesus had separated himself from them before, and he told them, go over to the other side. So they did. And in the middle of the night, Jesus came walking on top of the water. Jesus came walking on the water. And Peter saw him walking, and Peter said, hey, there comes the Lord, there comes the Lord. So Peter said, can I come and meet you? And Jesus said, yeah, come on, come on. So Peter jumps out of the boat, and he was walking on top of the water. And he was so excited, and he walked towards the Lord. And when he was almost at close to Jesus, he looked down and he saw the waves, and he took his eyes off Jesus. And when he looked at the waves, he sank and he would have drowned. And so Jesus reaches down and he pulls him up and he says, "O thou of little faith." Why did Jesus take his eyes off the Lord? I mean, why did he do that, Peter, I mean? So what I'm trying to bring across here this morning is, when we go through hardships, when we go through trials, let's not take our eyes off Jesus. Let's not take our eyes off God. You know, in Hebrew it says, "For the Lord disciples the one he loves and punishes everyone he receives, every son." Jesus will chastise us, but he will always love us. And in Peter it says, "Casting all you care upon him, which is Jesus Christ, for he cared for you." Nahum 1 verse 7 says, "The Lord is good, a stronghold in the day of trouble, and he knoweth them that trust in him." God knows those that trust in him. And yes, we go through trials. Yes, we go through hardships. You may go into a divorce, or maybe you just lost a child or a husband. Maybe your son or your daughter went to prison. Maybe your finances, you lost your job. You don't know how to meet ends. It's hard. Life is so hard. You know, we have to deal with all these hardships. People rebel against God, and they're disobedient, and a lot of people don't even believe in God. Or they may heard about Jesus, they may heard about God, but they don't want to accept him. They don't want to believe in him. They say, "You know, well, you know, who's God? You know, I can do everything on my own." Well, it doesn't work that way. It does not work that way. We cannot do anything on our own. We need Jesus. I need Jesus in my life from the time I get up in the morning to like go to sleep at night. And yes, we all face hardships. James says, "But let him ask in faith." Let him ask in faith. Nothing wavering. Nothing wavering. He says, "For he that answered is like a wave of the sea driven by the wind and tossed. He that wavers." Okay, "for let not that man think that he shall receive anything from the Lord." So when we waver in our faith, God says, "You will not receive anything." If we go, well, today we say, "Oh, I trust God." Tomorrow we say, "Oh, I don't trust God. You know, he doesn't do anything for me. What has he done for me?" That's wavering. We're going from one belief to the other. And I know that it is hard to keep your faith through hardship. It is hard when the money is not coming in on a date on a monthly basis or on a weekly basis. It is very hard. And I'm not, you know, we've all been through this. I have been through hardship in my life. Over and over and over, starting when I was a child, as a teenager, and later on with my teenage children. And, you know, finances, health-wise. A lot of times we face hardship because we abuse our bodies. We do abuse our bodies. You know, we smoke. We do drugs, we drink, we become alcoholics, or we sin against God. We become bitter. Unforgiveness and bitterness brings a lot of illness to our hearts, to our bodies. Bitterness, it destroys you. Hatred, it will destroy you. And so we face all the illnesses, the sicknesses. Some of them can be prevented by just loving the Lord and trusting the Lord and loving everybody else around us. It is not hard to say to another person, "You know what? I love you and I care for you. Jesus loves you." Why do we have to hate everybody? Why do we have to make such divisions between races and color, and, you know, just because I don't like him and I don't like her? this is hatred, this is bitterness, this is resentment, and you will have to pay the consequences for that. If we don't walk with Jesus in love every day, we will have to suffer the consequences. Sadly to say, that's what's going to happen to us. You know, hardship, like I said, hardship will knock on everybody's door because God is going to test us over and over and over again. All to our lives, He's going to put us to a school. He's going to teach us the Holy Spirit. What I have experienced in my life is the Holy Spirit teaches me, and I learn, I study the Word, I study the Bible, I go to Bible study, I pray, I have fellowship with Jesus, and so we learn and we saturate our spirit with the Word of God. And after a while, there comes a test. And you know, just like you go to school, you send your children to school, grammar school, they learn all these things, and then comes the test. And if you fail your test and you don't graduate into the second grade, you have to go to that first grade again, or the second or the third grade. Whatever grade you fail, you have to do it over. And it's the same in life. God teaches us, He shows us things, He reveals things to us, and then it comes to test. And if we fail the test, guess what? We have to go through it again. The Israelites, Moses led them through the wilderness for 40 years. Well, what did they do? They grumbled, they complained, they didn't like the manna, they didn't like anything. They were constantly complaining about Moses, constantly, why did we come out of Egypt? Why don't we go back to Egypt? Well, you know, God was not pleased with them at all. And so what happened? They did not pass their test. They flunked their test. They could have made that trip from Egypt into the Holy Land in probably 3 to 4 weeks. But because of their murmuring, because of their rebellion, their disobedience, their constantly complaining, God said, you know what? I'm going to take you around this mountain again and again and again. It took them 40 years to get through that wilderness. They could have been through in a month. 40 long years because of their rebellion. And so that's, we have to realize that God deals with us on the same basis. God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. God never changes. God never changes. The same God that we're serving now, Jesus Christ of Nazareth, He was already there with Adam and Eve. He was already there in the beginning. God never changes. And why should He treat us any different from the way He treated the people in the Old Testament? Because Jesus loves us. He loves us so much. And if you are going through trials, keep your faith and don't give up. Don't give up. Sometimes God, it takes a while before He answers our prayers. You know, when we pray about something we wanted yesterday, we say, you know, I prayed about this and God is not doing anything and I don't see anything happening. Well, maybe God is doing something behind the scenes and you just don't see it. You just don't know what He's doing because He does not have to explain to us, I'm doing this and I'm doing this. And remember, in Isaiah chapter 40, verse 31, it says, but they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings of eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. So God is telling us that if we wait upon the Lord and trust Him, nothing can go wrong. He will be with us. He will go with us through the fire. He will go with us through the water. He will go with us into the lion's den. He will always be with us. And in Philippians, it says in chapter 4, verses 6 and 7, be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be known unto God. And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. When you pray, when you have a problem, go to God. Thank Him for what He's done for you. If you count your blessings, you will notice that you have more blessings than hardships. If you write them all down and say, God did this and this and this and this. So thank Him. Whenever you approach God, thank Him for what He's done. Sometimes you may not feel like praising Him. You may not feel like thanking Him because you're so consumed with your pain and your hardship and your tears and, you know, your heart is broken. But go to Christ. Don't blame Him. Never, ever, ever blame Jesus. Never blame Him for anything that's happening in your life. Don't point your fingers at Him. You're pointing your finger at the wrong person. Life brings hardship. Wrong decisions bring hardship. People have hatred in their heart. They retaliate against you. They do things to you that you don't deserve. Take it to Jesus. Take it to God in prayer. Lay it out before Him and say, Lord, this is what's happening. I need your help. Please help me. We have a wonderful, wonderful Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He is our God. He is so mighty. And the Holy Spirit, He helps us as well. So why don't we go to Him and ask Him for help? You know, the one that you need to blame is always the devil. It's Satan himself. He comes to kill, to steal, and to destroy. He robs you of your money. He robs you of your job. He steals you. He steals your friends away from you. He turns other people against you. We have to blame the right person here, which is always the enemy. But God is good. God is good. He loves you so very much. And God will always, like I said, God will test your faith throughout your life. All your life long, you will be tested. Job was tested. Job was tested. I told you about Job a little while ago. Well, what happened? He had faith. He loved the Lord. He praised Him. He worshipped Him. And then came his friends. Then came his friends. And they started complaining until Job finally started feeling sorry for himself. So when you go through hardships, don't go to your friends. Go to Jesus Christ. Go to the one that can help you. Nobody can help you in this life. Nobody can. Yes, people can assist you. People can give you advice. People can help you out. Of course, people help you. But all help comes from the Lord. All help comes from the Lord. And when Noah was building the ark, he had to walk through faith. It took him up 100 years to build the ark, but he did it with God. So I urge you this morning that you really seek the Lord through all your trials and tribulations. And I want to pray with you this morning. And I want to, if there's anybody out there that has not received Jesus into his heart or into her heart, I urge you to do that today. So let me pray. You repeat after me, and then I pray for you that the Lord will help you through your hardship. Say, Lord Jesus, please come into my heart. I believe that you are the Son of God, that you died for my sins, that you arose from the grave, that you are alive today. And I want you to come into my heart, into my life. I turn my heart over to you. I surrender my heart to you. And I want to become born again. I want to be a child of God. Please forgive me for all my sins. Wash me and cleanse me with your precious blood in the name of Jesus. And if you prayed that prayer earnestly with all your heart, not just lip service, but with all your heart, then you are now a born-again Christian. You are a child of God. And now I pray for you. Father God, I pray, Lord, for all these broken-hearted people that are out there that are listening to me this morning. And it may be because they brought it on themselves, or they may be going through a test, or maybe they just made a wrong decision or some wrong choices, or maybe they're just being attacked by the enemy, Father. Whatever it is, that they're going through hardship, Father. I just pray, Lord, that you will stretch forth your mighty arm and that you will touch my brothers and sisters out there now in the name of Jesus Christ, and that you will lift those hardships from their shoulders and increase their trust and faith in you, O God. And let them turn to you and let them give all their hardships to you this morning, Lord God. And I pray, Father, that you will meet their needs and their financial needs and their physical needs, Lord, and heal their broken relationships, Lord, and give them peace and tranquility, Father, and touch them way down in their souls, Father, because they are hurting. And I thank you for that, Lord God. I praise you, Lord God. I give you all the glory and honor, Lord, because you are such a wonderful, wonderful God. And I pray, Lord, that you will bring healing to these people. Heal them. Heal their minds. Heal their hearts. Heal their spirits. Heal their emotions. Father, I pray that you will set them free, whatever the enemy puts in their mind, that you will deliver them and set them free in the name of Jesus Christ, Lord. Let the enemy not have his way with our brothers and sisters in Christ out there that are listening to me this morning, Father. But bless these people, bless your children, and increase their trust and faith in you, O Lord. And Father, I thank you and I praise you, Lord God, for what you have done in my life and what you have done in my loved ones' lives. And Lord, I thank you for what you've done in my friends' lives and everyone that I know, Lord. We have so many testimonies, Lord, and we give you the glory and honor. And I pray, Lord, that all these people that are listening to me now, that they will all be blessed and that they will all put their sorrows to the side and take a minute and sit before you or stand before you or get on their knees and say, God, I'm crying out to you today. Please help me. Please, please, Lord, I need your help. And I can guarantee you, my brothers and sisters, that God will not turn you away. God will never say no to you. He will always love you because he is the Almighty God. And he loves you regardless who you are and what you are. He is no respecter of person. And so I just thank you for listening to me this morning. And God bless you. And remember, Jesus loves you and I love you. And I will see you again next week. God bless you. Keep your eyes on Jesus.